Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the diversity training. Our guest today is Barbara Cheeves. She is the president and CEO of Converge and Associates Consulting. Converge specializes in race and ethnic relation consulting, employee relations and community engagement. She's also developed a training niche in equity and inclusion, cultural competency, implicit bias, racial equity, and respectful communications in the workplace. Her clients range from government entities, schools, law enforcement, public safety, and not-for-profit organizations, as well as media, education, and public corporations. Please join me in welcoming Barbara. Thank you.
Thanks, Colette. Good afternoon, everybody. So how many of you have been around here long enough to have heard me at least once or twice before in the past? I figured this is like coming back home again, so it's nice to be back with you again. And today we're doing culture, bias, and communication in the workplace. So we're going to start with some objectives today. First one is we're going to review diversity and culture. Again, for those of you who have heard me before, it'll be a refresher. We're going to talk about the difference between explicit bias and implicit bias. We're going to talk about what microaggressions are, which might be a new term for some of you. We're going to highlight respectful communication and interactions toward the end, and then talk about how our unconscious bias can affect our behavior. So I've got some guidelines and agreements, and they're the ones I've always used. So some of you have seen these before, and I always use them with every training. And the first is to understand that we're all experts in our own experiences. And what do I mean by that? We've all lived a life. Some of us have lived our lives longer than others. We've lived in different places, different countries, different parts of this country. We come from different work experiences. And we know us. You know, we tend to think when we work with people that we know what's best for everybody. But we're all experts in our own experiences. So because of that, we want to respect everybody's experiences, values, and opinions because they're theirs. We want to speak for ourselves and not for others. We tend to ask people to speak for their group. You know, what do your people think? You know, whatever the your people group is. And we can't. And we shouldn't try to speak for our group, and we shouldn't ask other people to speak for theirs. Being non-judgmental is my kind of funny agreement, because we're human, so what are we? We're judgmental. Of course we are, always. I always suggest that we work on working on being non-judgmental. Say, Alchin, that educate is my favorite. I am fairly certain that most people do not wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to go out and offend somebody today. Most people. There are a few. We offend people because we say things that they find offensive, and sometimes we don't even know what we said. Or somebody might offend you, and they walk away and they have no idea that you're offended. So imagine if you could just say, ouch. And ouch means I found that offensive. Educate means you have to tell me why. So I don't do or say it again to offend you or somebody else. Confidentiality, what's said in the room stays in the room. I don't care how many people you tell what I say, but if anybody else speaks or asks a question or has a comment, then we want to keep it here. Take risks. Today's your chance. Anything you want to talk about that's on these slides today or not, feel free. This is your opportunity. And the last is to expect unfinished business. I've got a lot of tools in my trainer toolkit. I don't have a magic wand. So at the end of this, I can't say, poof, you're bias-free. Or poof, you're culturally competent. Because you know what, if I did, I would use it here first, because I know that every minute of every day, I am not completely free of bias. I realize that, and I do this for a living. So we have to expect unfinished business, and it's a progress, or a process. So what is diversity? When you first hear diversity, the first two bullets come to mind. You think about the race, ethnicity, color, and national origin. Well, gender is diversity. I think we could probably all agree that men and women are not just alike. Age is diversity. We have six generations in some workplaces right now. There's a senior generation that's over 73 and either has retired and come back to work or hasn't retired yet. We have the baby boomers, which is where I live, or where I exist. Then we have our millennials. We older people say millennial like it's a curse word. Those millennials. Then we have Generation X and Y. And then we have Z. Generation Z is up to 21. Anybody in the room a Z? Well, if you don't have Z's working with you yet, you will very soon. That's six generations. That's a lot of difference. We look at work differently. We look at how to come to work differently. I bet if I went around this room and started asking how long people have been here, I found out here at Solid Waste, I hear 30-something years very often. Generation Z is never going to say that because they're not even thinking about going to work someplace that they will retire from. That's not even on their in their wildest dreams. So we look at work very differently based on our age or our generation. Religion's diversity. We just came out of a weekend, assuming everybody did the same thing we did. No. Some people worshiped on Sunday, some Saturday, some Friday, some for an hour, some all day, some not at all. So when we talk about religion, we're talking amazing diversity. Mental and physical ability. We are really good at making accommodations for people with physical disabilities. We are ADA compliant across the board, never a question. But how do we interact with people with disabilities? It's a little bit different. My youngest brother, 27 years ago, at 6'5", dove into a swimming pool and misjudged the pool and became a quad instantly. And he's the greatest guy in the world. He has the best sense of humor. He doesn't have an ounce of poor me in him. But he points something out to me. He lives in Augusta, so we meet in Atlanta from time to time. And when we go into a restaurant, typically a hostess will ask the gentleman, where would you like to sit or how many in the party? They never ask him. They ask me or his wife, the standing person. It's like they don't know how to talk to the person in the chair. We even had a waitress one day say, what would the gentleman like? I'm like, ask the gentleman. He's got no problem talking, but trust me, and he knows what he wants. And so we realize that we make accommodations, but how comfortable are we interacting with people and talking to them if you're not accustomed to it? Sexual orientation and gender identity. When I started doing this work 20 years ago, it was LGBT. It's become LGBTQIA, which is lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer or questioning, intersex, and asexual. The Q was queer or questioning. I can't say queer because when I was growing up, queer was a slur, so it just doesn't come out of my mouth. But I do a lot of work with Compass Gay and Lesbian Center. They assure me that it's fine. When I started doing this work, as I said, 20 years ago, the LGBT community was 10% of the population. The quoted number is still 10%, and I don't buy it. It's much larger than 10%. And we are much better in the workplace about not telling black jokes and Polish jokes and Jewish jokes. We're not good about gay jokes. I hear them all the time. So you don't know who you're offending, or if you're offending that person, or their sibling, or their child, or their parent. So we want to be mindful of what we say. To transgender, I always like to pause there for a moment because one of the cities that I work with, I was with earlier this week, or last week, and they have two employees that are transgender. One was a man who's become a woman, one is a woman who's become a man. So if you haven't encountered that in your workplace yet, it's at some point you will. So we have to be mindful of how we manage. And then family and marital status. This diversity is the legal diversity. This is the stuff that Colette and HR cares about a lot. A couple of years ago, I did harassment and bullying training with you. This is the things that harassment suits are made of. So we want to be sure that we're not defying these pieces of diversity. But there's more to who we are. There's more diversity. I call this my culture wheel. So the language you speak. Everybody at Solid Waste Authority does not speak English as a first language. We have many people in here that do not. That means we have many different accents also. And we want to be very mindful not to tease about accents. I often hear people say that word again, because you say it funny. I like the way it sounds. That's not funny. I was someplace one day doing a training, and a gentleman introduced himself, and one of his colleagues, he had a very deep accent. One of his colleagues said, would you like me to translate for him? And I said, no, I understood him perfectly, but I've got a remedial class for you and this one's over, because that wasn't necessary. So we have to be conscious of people and their accents. Communication, how we communicate based on our culture. Some cultures are loud and expressive, like me. Some cultures are quiet and reserved. One of my best friends is a Japanese-American man who lives in Honolulu. Sadly, his mother passed away before I ever got to meet her, and he always said, oh, you would make my mother crazy, because I come bounding into the house, and his mother was a very traditional Japanese woman, very quiet, never raised her voice, still bowed from the waist, very subservient, very everything that you think about, if you the stereotypical Japanese woman was his mother. So we still have people that have very, very different ways of communicating based on their culture. Our courtesies are different based on our culture. I'm a New Yorker, which you can probably tell. You'll be able to tell more next week because I'm going home for the weekend, hurricane willing. But when I moved to Florida 30 years ago, and my friends' kids are calling me Miss Barbara, it's like, what is that? What do they have to do that? And they would say, yes, because that's respectful. I'm like, well, I respected my parents' friends, but we didn't do Miss or Mr. anything. So courtesies are different from culture to culture. One of the people here, one of the times I trained several years ago, told me that in his country, he'd come here to work, and he was astounded that people called you by your first name in the workplace. He said, where he came from, that would never happen. You were Mr. somebody or Miss somebody. And I will date myself, because I started working in the 70s. As I think about it, we did too. You know, when I was first working, you never called the boss by their first name. It was always Mr. or Ms. or Mrs. Our rituals, how we celebrate our weddings, our funerals are very different based on our culture. I often tell a story about funerals. A colleague of mine is Jewish, and she called me one day and said one of her coworkers, who's African-American, had lost her father, and she wanted to go pay her respects. She said she'd been to very few churches in her life and had never been to a black church, so she wanted to know what she should expect. So I said, are you going to the funeral of the wake? And she told me, so I basically told her what the wake would be like. And she called me about an hour and a half later, very, very angry with me and sobbing hysterically. She said, I knew I was going to the wake. I didn't expect to meet the man. Jews are buried by sunset the next day whenever possible and not embalmed typically, no open casket. She had never seen an open casket. She was devastated. She said, he's looking at me. I said, I'm pretty sure he wasn't looking at you. But she was mad at me because I didn't tell her. And why didn't I tell her? Because it's what I expect. You know, it wouldn't be unique to me. You know, now I know the difference. Shortly thereafter, or a couple of years later, a Bahamian friend lost his brother, and I wanted to go to the wake. They gave me the address. It was in Boynton. I'm driving around this neighborhood looking for a church or a funeral parlor, and I can't find one. So I call somebody and said, where is this thing? And they said, oh, no, he's Bahamian. It's in the house. Traditional Bahamians brought them home. So you would never know how people have their rites and rituals unless you started talking to one another about it. The roles we play, our customs. How do you celebrate Christmas in your house, or Easter, or Hanukkah, or Ramadan? You know, this is Rosh Hashanah today. You know, so how we celebrate those holidays from culture to culture. Your relationships, your practices. When's dinner? In some countries and cultures, dinner's a 5 o'clock thing. If you're in Spain, dinner's a 9 o'clock thing. And so it's very, very different. In some cultures, dinner is everybody's at the table and nobody's eating until dad comes home from work and we all sit down and eat together. In some cultures, you grab it and you go. Our expected behaviors. In some cultures, kids are seen and not heard, ever. In some cultures, kids are a part of the conversation, and in some cultures, they're a part of the decision-making process. Our values, our thoughts, and how we interact, all of that is who we are. So there's depth to who we are, a lot more depth than just what you see on the surface. And yet we interact with people every day based on just what we see and not knowing any of the things on our culture wheel, which are so important. Very often when two cultures come together, we can have what we call, we can have an interaction that's called a cultural bump. Something went amiss. So the cultural bump can leave you feeling lots of different ways. It can leave you confused. Let's say the cultural bump is about an accent and you really cannot understand and you're trying, but you can't. That's a cultural bump. A cultural bump can leave you frustrated. Do some of you know that different cultures have different relationships to time? For some cultures, it's 4 o'clock, it's 4 o'clock. I spend a lot of time in the Caribbean. 4 o'clock meeting doesn't necessarily mean 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock social engagement definitely doesn't mean 4 o'clock. It happens when it happens. I have a friend who's from the Caribbean who printed 2 sets of wedding invitations. Seriously, one for her work colleagues and one for her family from back home, because she wanted her wedding to start on time. Her family had one that had an hour ahead of everybody else, so they'd get there on time, because she knows. So that can leave you frustrated. If you're like time sensitive and somebody isn't, it can be extremely frustrating. And I will tell you that we are more time sensitive than most. If you go around the Mediterranean, people are a little bit more laid back about time. I'm going to Africa in 2 weeks. I'm guessing it's going to be the same thing, kind of laid back. I call it warm weather time. Caribbean, the Mediterranean are a little bit different than we are with time. Cultural bumps can leave you angry. Let's say it's the culture of politics. I would imagine if right now we started having a political discussion, which we won't, we could have a huge cultural bump in this room, because we come from many different places as it relates to politics. It can leave you misunderstood if you left the encounter not knowing what happened, or it can leave you helpless and hopeless. And the example I use for helpless and hopeless is from a firefighter, female, firefighter medic. She was called to the scene of a car accident that was a near fatal accident. And she immediately engaged and went to the person who was most in trauma. It was a man. And as she's trying to treat him, he's through his daze, he's backing away from her. And he's backing away. And she doesn't know why. And she's trying to like get to his clothes. And finally, one of the women who was in better shape said, "He's a Muslim man. He cannot be touched by somebody who's not his wife. It would be a sin." And he didn't think he was going to live, or he wasn't sure he was going to live, and he didn't want his last act on earth to be a sin. She was very understanding. She quickly grabbed one of the male medics and switched places and let him take care of the man, and she went to take care of somebody else. But imagine how helpless and hopeless both of them could have felt in that situation. So very often I look at encounters that I have. When you have an encounter with somebody, you want to get angry or frustrated or angry or misunderstood or confused, and I just go, cultural bump. It makes it a little bit easier, and then we go on, then we move on. So I'm going to put you to work. I'm going to have you read out loud, nice and loud and rapidly, the color of the ink, starting in the upper left-hand corner and going across to the right and then down. Go. Faster. All right, everybody understands the instructions, correct? I'm going to flip the screen and have you do the exact same thing. Read the color of the ink. Go for it. Some of you got it. I'm hearing a few of you that got it. Everybody did. You can stop. That sounds horrible because I'm hearing to both sides. Your tendency, our tendency, is to say blue because that's what you're looking at. Because we think we that's our rapid response. And we have a rapid response to just visible things very quickly. And we do the same thing with people. We have a rapid response to people. So, and I'll take this a little bit deeper now, because a man named Daniel Kahneman, who was an economist, who won a Nobel Peace Prize for social science, go figure, says that we have two brains. We have a system one brain and a system two brain. Our system one brain is always running. It's constantly going without your knowledge or your permission. You don't have to tell it. Your system one brain is constantly doing something. You didn't just say, "I'm going to wipe my face." It just happened. You didn't say, "I'm going to scratch my chest." You just did it. System one breathes for you. System one is also your fight or flight. If you go to the beach this next weekend and you're in the ocean and you see something silver sticking up, system one doesn't allow you to think, maybe that's a piece of a boat, maybe it's a piece of a shark. Your system one says, could be a shark, get out. So system one helps you live. System one knows, keeps you safe, it helps you breathe, and it's constantly happening. System two is completely the opposite. System two is deliberate. You have to engage it. You have to make it happen. System one read the first screen. It didn't have to think. It just did it. In order to read the second one, you had to engage System 2. A little secret about System 2 is because it has to be engaged, it's also lazy. It doesn't want to work. It really would be very happy to let System 1 merrily go about your life so it doesn't have to do anything. Somewhere along the line, your parents all told you to treat everybody the same, to treat others as you would want to be treated, the old golden rule. You understood that clearly. That still lives in everybody's System 2 brain. But System 1 doesn't care. System 1 just goes running about its business. Why does this matter to me? Or why do I want it to matter to you? Because System 1 is effortless, it's fast, it's patterns and association, it's your unconscious mind. System 1 is your unconscious. System 2 takes work, it's slow, it's conscious, and again, it's lazy. We have two levels of bias, implicit and explicit. Explicit bias is bias that you know you have. You are clear. If I gave you a piece of paper right now and told you to write down two of your biases, you could do it. You don't want to, but you could. Those are the biases I don't worry so much about because you know you have them. So I tell on myself all the time, so I, for many years, had an explicit bias. Got much better, took a little work. I had to be conscious about it. Sorry, don't, if you can say ouch if you want to. But I had a bias for most of my life about tattoos. Didn't like them, didn't understand them. Well, in 2022, I would like not talk to anybody if I didn't talk to people, somebody that had a tattoo. So I've had to realize that it was a bias and deal with it as such, which so I'm good. But it was an explicit bias, I knew I had it. Here's the scary piece for me. If you've ever taken a psychology class, you read that 95 to 98% of what you process in your life is in your unconscious mind. Which means your unconscious mind is where your implicit biases live, the biases that you don't even know you have. And they're running all the time, 95 to 98% of the time. That's frightening. So there's little things that come up. You're driving down 95 and there's somebody in the left-hand lane. You're in the left-hand lane. The person in front of you is going 45 miles an hour. What's the first thing that comes to your mind? Who are they? Hmm? They're old. They always say they're old. That's the first thing I hear from people. They're old people. Of course, now that I've become a senior citizen, I like take offense to that because I speed. So I reject that. But we do, we think that. I said those millennials before. Those are our biases. Those are all our biases. And we have biases about everybody in the world. Everybody. When you're driving home tonight and you're stopped at a light at some point, look to your right or your left at the car. You absolutely have that person all figured out. There's something, and you're not doing it intentionally. It just happens. Color of the car, type of car, bumper sticker, what's hanging from the windshield, the rear view mirror, what kind of music is coming out of the car, what do they look like? And it's funny because this morning I said to the group that I had pulled up next to a Bentley the other day and I had my whole thought process about a Bentley. Don't you know when I left here today to go home for lunch, I pulled up next to a big black Bentley. I go, well, there you go. And I have these thoughts about who is that in the Bentley? You know, who is that person? I've got them all figured out. So we have to be very mindful to manage those implicit biases that we don't know we have. And the issue with the implicit bias is your conscious mind will argue and say, I don't have that bias. It could be people from a country that you've never been to. It could be people from a neighborhood that your mother told you to stay away from 50 years ago. And it's still running in the back of your mind. This is from Kahneman's book, and I love it because it's System 1 running out front with System 2 trying to catch up. I often say that my System 1 speaks before System 2 can tell it to shut up. That's that old, did I really just say that out loud? That's System 1. It just speaks. So you have to be mindful as you're looking at people and making these snap judgments, realize that System 1 is at work. And it will actually make you pause and think about the opinion or the thought that you just had. So I keep saying bias. What is it? It's prejudice in favor of or against a thing, person, or group compared with another, usually in a way to be unfair. So I always put this up because I want you to hear that prejudice and bias can be in favor of. So how many of you have grandchildren? So they're perfect little people because they're your grandchildren. Were your kids perfect? Nah, but those perfect little grandchildren, you just can't wait to see them because they're just perfect little beings. And there's nothing wrong with that, but it's prejudice and it's bias in favor of. It's a good thing. There's nothing wrong with it, but it's still prejudice and bias. Where in the workplace can positive prejudice or bias be a problem? How could it be a problem? Somebody. Come on. Somebody knows the answer to that.
When you have to work with someone.
Yeah, but if you have a positive bias, what could be wrong with that?
Show them favoritism over another employee.
Bingo. Absolutely. Positive bias leads to favoritism, promotions in many cases, favorable reviews, time off, the best office, pick something, the best shift. Positive favoritism, positive bias can be very detrimental in the workplace as much as negative bias. So where does it come from? Where do we get our biases from? Where do you get them from? Your parents, your siblings, your friends, your community, your experience. We can't discount our experience. If you have if you meet three people over a course of time who are of the same whatever box it is, and you have negative interactions with them, the fourth one you meet will be hard-pressed to tell you that they're not the same as the other three because you've already made a decision because it's your experience. What entity feeds your bias every single day that you interact with? There is an entity that we all interact with that feeds our biases every day of our lives. What is it?
The internet?
The what?
The internet?
Yep. Media, period. Media, internet, television, Facebook. 2 years ago, I was doing training with a police department in Broward County, and it was the summer of George Floyd. So I'm working with these police officers. I've been training police officers for 20 years. I have all the respect in the world for the police. And I'm not gonna stand here and say that they're all perfect by any means, but I have the greatest respect for them and what they do. But I said to them this day, so you guys are getting a really bad rap these days. Nobody's liking the cops at all. And they're like, no, it's actually kind of scary. So I said, well, has anybody in this department done anything to make the community feel badly about police? And they all said, no, we're like small. We're a small city. We're big on community policing. People actually like us here. I said, so what's the problem? It's that everybody's painting the cops with the same broad brush. I'm like, yeah, not fair, is it? So there's two sides to that coin, though. Because what I said to them was, you're absolutely right. And why are they painting it with the same broad brush? Because the media showed Derek Chauvin over and 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 over again. He just kept seeing that image. And he wasn't the only one that summer. Other things happened, but we kept seeing them on television. So I said to them, you're absolutely right. The media has portrayed you as awful. It has painted you with the same broad brush. But my second part of it was, how many people do you all paint with the same broad brush? Because the media also gives you what they believe to be a stereotypical criminal. And they keep showing you that face over and over and over and over as well. So you have to be very mindful about what you're fed through television, through the internet, through Facebook, through all of media, because it will skew your judgment. So I've got a little video for you that's gonna speak a lot about what I've been saying. But you'll hear it from some other voices.
Implicit bias exists when we unconsciously hold attitudes towards others or associate stereotypes with them. For example, we often harbor negative stereotypes about others without consciously realizing that we do so. Implicit bias, which is also called unconscious bias or implicit social cognition, is a prejudice that is deep-seated within the brain, below the conscious level. Studies have demonstrated implicit bias against racial groups, genders, LGBTQ, and other marginalized groups. We may even be prejudiced against our own group, although we tend to favor our in-group with positive stereotypes and disfavor out-groups with negative stereotypes.
The immediate feeling you get or the immediate thoughts you have about a person, an assumption you feel, just anything you feel, really stems somewhere from an experience you've had or your upbringing.
It depends on the region you're from, the country you're from, the background you grew up in. That shapes the person's unconscious bias.
I think sometimes you don't even realize it, but your own actions, maybe the way you treat others as opposed to treating others that look like you or that act like you or that are your friends.
Implicit bias often runs counter to people's conscious, expressed beliefs. Few physicians espouse racially discriminatory views, and yet doctors tend to recommend less pain medication for black patients than for white patients with the identical injury. In other words, people can be explicitly unbiased, yet implicitly biased, according to psychologist Daniel Kelly and colleagues.
One of my closest friends since high school, we've worked on a lot of projects together, we've been in a lot of classes together. Sometimes we'd be working together in a group project, for example, and she would say stuff like, oh, you're good at math, you're good at science, here, you can take this part of the project or something. I don't hold it against her or anything, and she doesn't mean any harm by it, but obviously there's that implicit sort of bias or stereotype that Asians are better at math and science.
Implicit bias has been found in a large array of studies using various tests, but much of the evidence for the phenomenon comes from Harvard University's Project Implicit website, home of the Implicit Association Test, or the IAT. Literally millions of people have visited this site and taken various tests that ask them to respond rapidly to questions that require them to associate blacks or whites, males or females, or young or old, etc., with positive or negative words.
Most of the implicit biases that I've run into are probably positive ones, things that come with being a white male and having height and having a good voice and things like that.
Professor Nosek and colleagues tested more than 700,000 subjects and found that more than 70% of white subjects more easily associated white faces with positive words and black faces with negative words, concluding that this was evidence of implicit racial bias. In fact, additional evidence indicates that measures of implicit bias better predict people's conduct than measures of explicit bias.
I think that if you are anyone, to be blunt, that it's not a white male, you potentially feel that implicit bias. Maybe you're just looking for someone that is like you because you like you, and so you want to be around more people like you. But what's really rooted under that is that you potentially don't think that someone else is as smart or as capable, and that is coming from a place of implicit bias.
Now here's some good news. Various scientists have criticized the IAT. They point out, for example, that individuals who take the test on different dates often score substantially differently. Even IAT supporters admit that implicit bias, at least as demonstrated by the test, is widespread but relatively minor and has only a small impact upon people's real-world actions. In other words, the results of the test are not strong enough to predict particular behaviors by individual people. However, let's not get too comfortable. Even if the IAT cannot predict the future conduct of any one individual on a given occasion, it still indicates how groups of people will act on average, and that is worrisome. For example, few people openly advocate for discrimination in hiring. But white applicants receive 50% more responses from potential employers than do black applicants with the same resume. Likewise, college professors are substantially more likely to answer student emails if the students' names indicate that they are probably white than if the names sound like they belong to black students. And in one study, online course instructors were 94% more likely to respond to discussion posts by white male students than by other students.
There are a lot of opportunities to promote people within the workplace. It doesn't happen because of different biases. People assume, you know, a woman is of a certain age or they're married and you think, oh, she's going to want to have kids, so we're not going to give her this really tough big project.
When I graduated from West Point in 2009, I went to my first organization, the first unit assignment. I was the only Latino officer in a group of about 100 other officers. Yeah, I think there was a lot of like hesitation in really following my lead as a leader for the organization. I think it hindered in some way like the ability for us to like build cohesive trust within our organization and really have that going into a combat environment.
Because implicit bias operates at a mostly unconscious level, it is difficult for individuals to overcome. No existing training regime has proven particularly effective at de-biasing implicit bias. But fortunately, some research shows that stereotypes can be unlearned and that safeguards can be put in place to minimize their impact. For example, women used to make up only a relatively small percentage of the musicians in orchestras. But when orchestras began holding blind auditions, where the applicants played behind a curtain and their genders were unknown to the judges, the percentage of women chosen to play in symphony orchestras doubled. Perhaps we can put a dent in implicit bias after all.
These biases are sometimes so deep-rooted within us or within our culture that we don't even realize that they are biases.
We could have a mutually, you know, beneficial conversation and really benefit from learning from each other and really understand that we're all not that different.
Listen, really absorb the experiences of those around you, especially those who come from backgrounds that are unlike yours.
Learn something new about a person, and then that will kind of help shift that bias, because now you've actually ask that person, or now you get to know that person.
There's so many opportunities to engage with others, to say, I don't want to do this again. Can you help me not do that? And people are willing to have those conversations.
Just a lot of what I said, but through different voices. It's nice to hear it done that way. So the word microaggressions. I mentioned it before, earlier when I started. Not a new concept, but a new word for many of us. It's not a word I knew before about 3 years ago. And so microaggressions happen every day. They're commonplace, they're verbal, they're things that are said that are slights against people. They communicate hostile and derogatory thoughts. It may be completely unintentional. There are macroaggressions that are very intentional. That's when you're really hurling racial epithets at people or sexist comments at people or ageism things at people. So those are the macroaggressions. Microaggressions are subtle. And again, often unintentional, not really intended to harm. But they're prejudicial slights, and they're typically against or particularly against culturally marginalized groups. So what do I consider to be culturally marginalized groups? Who's considered to be culturally marginalized groups? Immigrants, Latinos, Hispanics, African Americans, LGBTQ plus community. I'm on the board of the Lord's Place, the homeless, marginalized group. People with handicaps, very often a marginal. Women in some communities are marginalized groups. So these are the slights that are said on a regular basis, day in and day out, that prick. They're little everyday exchanges, and they send negative messages to people of a certain group. And very often, people are not aware of the potential impact of their words. So they took a group of young people, somebody did an exercise, and they asked a group of young people, what microaggression do you hear about yourself? And so they all made a little sign. Her sign says, what are you, is what she hears. And her answer is human. Being biracial does not make me a what. She hears people are constantly saying, what are you? And a friend of mine is a white woman who has three gorgeous biracial grandchildren, and she was pushing the baby down the street one day, and a neighbor looked into the stroller and said, oh, he's beautiful, what is he? And she said, he's my grandson, is what he is. What the neighbor really wanted to know was, why is he brown? Who's his father? You know, what's his race? A, none of your business, and B, if that's what you want to know, ask it, but not what is he. I have a friend that I went to high school with, so that's a bazillion years ago, and I just talked to her the other night, and I brought this up because she always used to get, when we were younger, what are you? And she said, you know what, I still get it. People still have the nerve to look at me. She lives in D.C., and we were together one day, and I heard a woman, we're sitting next to one another, and a woman says, you know, I've always wondered, what are you? And I'm like, oh, this isn't going to be pretty. This response is not going to be good, because she hates that, and I can't blame her. So that was this young lady's response. This guy says, you don't act like a normal black person, you know? So they had a backstory to some of these in the article that I pulled these from. And he's like from Oklahoma, he's big into cattle ranching, and when he moved to the city, people are saying, you don't act like a normal black person. So his question was, I act like everybody I grew up with, so what's normal? Who decides what's normal? What does that mean? This one says, Courtney, I never see you as a black girl. And her response is, well, open your eyes. And I relate to Courtney, because I've heard that so many times. I've had people make comments during a conversation, and I look at them and they go, oh, but we don't see you as black. And I go, really? I do. And if I were gonna hold a sign like these kids, my sign would say, I don't see color. Because there's absolutely no way anybody doesn't see color. You know, I know what people mean. What they mean is, I don't treat you differently because of your color or your race. But to say I don't see color basically says you don't see me, because that's who I am. So that's a comment that several people wouldn't realize that we hear a lot. This one says, just because I'm Mexican doesn't mean I should be the automatic choice to be Dora the Explorer in the school play. And part of her backstory also says that because she's Mexican, every time they all go out to lunch together, people assume she wants to go for tacos. She's like, how about a burger? You know, what's that assumption? Why do you assume that's what I want? And this one says, you don't speak Spanish? And she said she gets it from all sides. She is clearly Latina. She's born in this country. Her parents are both born in this country. She's never been to the country of her ancestors, her grandparents. She never learned Spanish. And she said Spanish-speaking people just assume that she's supposed to speak Spanish because they think she's trying to be cutesy because she won't speak to them. And then English-speaking people expect her to translate or interpret, and they can't. So she gets it from both sides. This young man says the limited representation of my race in your classroom does not make me the voice for all black people. You remember my first slide of the day? Don't speak for yourself and not for others. Apparently his teacher was asking him to speak for his group. And the last one is a young lady. She says, so you're Chinese, right? She's not. If you look at her, I wouldn't know what Asian ethnicity she was. She could be Laotian, Vietnamese, Korean, Japanese. She said, but Americans always default to Chinese. They just say, oh, they're Chinese, you know, without ever asking where their families are really from. And my Caribbean friends tell me that Americans default to Jamaica. Anybody who has an accent, they say they're Jamaican. And they could be from almost any place. In fact, a couple of years ago, somebody said to me, have you met the new police chief in West Palm Beach? He's Jamaican. I said, yes, I've met him. He's Bahamian. So, you know, just example, they just go straight to Jamaican without ever asking where the person's really from. So these are microaggressions. So if these are heard over and over and over throughout your life, imagine it gets old. So I'm going to give you, again, another voice to tell you a little bit about microaggressions. I like the way she puts it.
In the realm of fighting against racism, there's one term that has brought a lot of fanfare and some controversy: microaggressions. Maybe you've heard this term. Maybe you have a visceral reaction and think, isn't that just a word overly sensitive young people use to complain? Sometimes the media can portray microaggressions this way, and that's too bad because it's actually a really important concept to understand. Once you do, you might realize you've been guilty of microaggressions against others, or maybe you've even experienced them yourself. Here's the thing about this trendy word. It's not new. The term microaggression was actually coined by psychologists in the 1970s. Only recently did it become a widely used term by lay people, though. And there's good reason for that. They describe a phenomenon that many marginalized people or minority group members recognized as a real thing that happens to them all the time. So what exactly are they? Microaggressions are comments or actions that reveal someone's biases against a minority or marginalized group. Unlike their more egregious counterparts of outright racism, homophobia, anti-Semitism, and other negative comments and actions, microaggressions are usually not meant to cause offense. They're most often casual comments that reflect ingrained, unconscious biases our whole society has against marginalized groups. They invoke stereotypes, and usually the people who perform microaggressions have no clue they're doing it. Some examples of microaggressions would be comments like, "You don't seem gay," "You're articulate for someone of your race," "Where are you really from?" "What are you?" Calling women sweetheart, maligning assertive women as bossy. There are many other examples, unfortunately. This is really just scratching the surface, but know that each of these comments relies on an underlying stereotype and assumption about a marginalized or minority group of people. That's what makes them microaggressions and not just run-of-the-mill rude comments. You may be thinking, but if I don't know I'm doing it and I'm not doing it on purpose to hurt someone, what's the harm? Can't people just toughen up? While it's true that the intent to harm usually isn't there with microaggressions, we all know intent doesn't matter much when a comment causes you harm. Try to think back to just a normal, rude, or insensitive comment someone made to you. How did that make you feel? Probably not that good, especially if it was aimed at something about you personally. Now imagine that various people you encounter at work, school, or in your day-to-day life all make those same kinds of comments to you all the time. This is how marginalized people and minorities view microaggressions. They're like paper cuts. On their own, they might not be that dangerous, but they're still nagging, annoying, and frustrating. But imagine you had 1,000 of them inflicted on you, one at a time, every day, or even multiple times a day. It doesn't really matter that they're small wounds if you have a ton of them. Over time, that's going to add up. That's going to really harm you. That's how minorities and marginalized groups feel about microaggressions aimed at them. It's not just occasional, because these are comments based on and influenced by society's biases. These are things they hear all the time. The onus should not be on the marginalized group to grin and bear it, because these are still inappropriate comments to make to others, regardless of intent. So maybe you're now convinced that microaggressions are something to be avoided. But wait, we said they're usually unconscious and unintentional. So how do you avoid something like that? Well, by being conscious and intentional, for starters. First, you'll need to understand the underlying unconscious biases we all have ingrained in us as part of our society. Watch our programming on that if you've never heard of unconscious biases or need a refresher. But basically, these are biases about groups of people based on our long history as a society. When you're more aware of them, you'll better know how to avoid invoking them in microaggressions. As for being intentional, well, that involves thinking before you speak. No, you shouldn't have to completely second guess every comment you make towards a minority or member of a marginalized group. But if you find yourself referring to their status as a member of one of those groups with your comments, Make sure your comments are not merely repeating a bias or assumption about that group of people. If they are, they're quite possibly microaggressions that could harm the other person if you voice them. Best to avoid saying something like that. What if someone else makes a comment you view as a microaggression, either towards you or someone else? Should you scold them and shame them? Not directly, because that doesn't really work or help anyone. Instead, try asking them this simple question: what do you mean by that? This will cause them to actually think about what they said. They might immediately realize that their comment had an air of bias to it and apologize. Or they might actually try to explain their comment. When they do that, you can reply with something like, "I don't think you realize it, but when you say something like that, it hurts my feelings." Usually, by the time you get to this point in the conversation, the person who's performed a microaggression will see the problem with their statement. They might even be embarrassed that they said something that could be perceived as racist, sexist, or homophobic. Because again, most people who commit microaggressions aren't doing it on purpose or intending to hurt someone. In fact, because we're all affected by society's biases, we've all been guilty of using microaggressions ourselves, even if we're part of a marginalized group ourselves. So you might also say something like, "I used to think or say things like that too, until I learned that people of that group hear that a lot and don't like it. It makes them uncomfortable." Now, if someone persists with their microaggressions, you might have a bigger problem. They might actually not be so innocent in their intent and could be using microaggressions as a way to get away with prejudiced comments that sound harmless enough on the surface. If that's the case, you may have to pick your battles with such people, or if you're at work, report them to HR. Because you don't want to place yourself in a dangerous situation by confronting someone who's actively racist or biased against your group. Let the professionals deal with the really tricky cases. But hopefully, those cases will be few and far between. The vast majority of microaggressions are not meant to cause harm. Reducing these microaggressions, both from yourself and from others, will ultimately lead to a social situation that's much more comfortable for minorities and people from marginalized groups. And when each of us thrive, all of us thrive. Just work towards a more conscious, intentional way of speaking and avoid careless, hurtful comments.
Does that make, I hope that clarifies what microaggressions is. As she says, it's not new, but it's something that we should all, and none of us are beyond them. And I said something a couple years ago, actually, and I got busted as a microaggression. And it was something about, I said to a Jamaican friend of mine, who's actually from Jamaica, how excited you must be that the new vice president is half Jamaican. And his response was, I didn't say how excited you are. I said, how excited Jamaicans are. And he looked at me and goes, I haven't asked all Jamaicans. And I went, ooh. You know, so again, you know, none of us are beyond, and if somebody points something out to you that you've said that they consider to be a microaggression, don't get upset. If someone says something to you that it's basically an ouch. It's that's the same thing as me saying ouch, you know, in the very beginning. People should feel free to say it, and you shouldn't get upset if they tell you. And acknowledge that you may not think it's offensive, but if they do, that's all it means. That's all that's required. If they think it's offensive, then it is. And these, I won't spend a lot of time on this, but these are some of the psychological consequences of repeated microaggressions, things that people hear over and over and over, particularly in the workplace, and particularly if the microaggressions are coming from a supervisor or a superior that has something to do with evaluating them and their lives at work. So implicit bias in employment, it can permeate the process at many stages with negative consequences. You heard them mention during the first video, a study that was done with the University of Chicago and Harvard about people not getting jobs and not even getting called for interviews based on their name on their resume, based on nothing else except their name, a quote unquote black sounding name or Hispanic sounding name. It can impact everyday interactions between administrators and people they manage. And it basically, you know, what we don't want is for us to favor individuals that are more like us or similar to ourselves. So we don't want to promote and value people who are more of a cultural match to us than the most qualified for the job. We'll always catch ourselves at that, because likeness to ourselves often gets compared to be trust and respect. They're like me, so I trust them and I respect them. So how do we de-bias? They talked about de-biasing a little bit in the film. It's not impossible. Education, we're starting. I mean, we're not starting. You've had it before. But education, hearing it, listening to it. Accountability, having people call you on it. I have a litany of accountability partners in my life that if I say something, I mean, I have one friend that says, oh, did Miss Cultural Competency just say that? Like, oh, yes, I did. Because none of us are immune. Deliberative processing, think about the ways that we think about others and try to understand where that perspective came from. Where did you get it? You know, I said at one point it may have come from your family, your friends, your upbringing, but check yourself, ask yourself where it came from. And then think about stereotypes that people might have about you. And if they were to say something about it, how would that make you feel? Counter the image. The only way you can replace a stereotypical image is to acknowledge that it's stereotypical. But then you replace the image. So I always use my very silly example, because everybody thinks New Yorkers are rude and obnoxious. I know this. I once saw a bumper sticker that said, if they did it so much better in New York, take 95 North. So yeah, so get them out of here, right? But so I always tell people, if you hear that New Yorkers are rude and obnoxious, you could say, no, they're not. I met Barbara. She's not rude and obnoxious. So, you know, you want to find something to counter the stereotype image. And then individuation, realizing, think back to that culture wheel. We are a lot more than just what you see. I used to do, when I think back to the culture wheel again, at one point I did an exercise that I would give everybody 3 post-it notes. And on the post-it notes, I would ask you to write 3 aspects of your culture. You could write your religion, your race, maybe you're a twin or a triplet, maybe you're an only child. You know, whatever you want to write on your card, could be your sexual orientation, could be your religion. And then I would draw a big iceberg on the wall and draw a water line. And I would tell you to go up to take your post-it notes and put them on the iceberg. If you wrote down something we could see about you, then you were to put your post-it note above the waterline. If you wrote something that we couldn't see about you, you put it below the waterline. Where do you figure 75% of the post-it notes ended up? Below. Because most of who you are, we can't see. So very often those microaggressions are geared at something that could be digging deeper than people realize. So one of the most important tools we believe in your toolbox is your own awareness of implicit bias as a reality, and your willingness to make that unconscious conscious so that you don't continue to make the comments or to feel that way about groups of people. And then focusing on intersections. None of us, there's no such thing as a single issue struggle. If we could take all of us in this room right now and put us someplace on these loops, we would have all kinds of intersections because we overlap. You know, we might be different ages and the same gender identity. We might be different professions and the same religion. Live from different places, our geography different or the same, and then our age different or the same. So there's so many intersections that we have, but we spend a lot of time thinking about our differences and not enough time thinking about how we intersect. And I will suggest that if you spent more time actually talking to people, you would find all kinds of intersections, and it would be easier to ignore the differences and focus on the sameness. And this one, speaking of differences and sameness, I got this slide from a friend who works in education with kids. And she calls it her windows and mirrors. We spend a lot of time, she says, looking in mirrors. And what do you see when you look in a mirror? You see yourself. And like the girl in the video said, you like yourself. So we compare everybody to ourselves. So it's easy to want to seek out people who look like that mirror. But if we spent more time looking out of windows, still glass, but looking out of windows, you get to see how other people live. You get a little glimpse of their experience, a little glimpse into their life, their religion, the foods they eat, the way they dress at home, the way they speak another language at home. You get a lot more, 25% of Palm Beach County speaks a language other than English at home. You won't know that, you know, so you start actually talking to people and getting a glimpse of who they really are. So as we wind down, we want to look a little bit at communication. And it's defined, Merriam-Webster says it's the exchange or flow of information from one person to another, the process of relating to other people by sharing thoughts and ideas. So what we look for and what we want and strive for is respectful communication. It's this slide actually I pulled from the last time I was here 2 years ago because it still fits. The power of words. Words mean different things to different people. I was doing something with a group the other day and somebody said, who's bringing the pop? And I forget that pop is soda for some people in the Midwest. I had to think for a minute, pop? So what do you call a sandwich between two pieces of hard bread with lots of meat and cheese and veggies inside? A sub lunch. I like that. A sub, what else? What else do we call it? A hoagie, what else? But there's other, a hero, some places. A poor boy.
A dagwood.
Yeah, there you go. I haven't heard that one in a long time. Is Blondie still in the comic strips? I'm not even sure. Some of the younger people probably don't know who Dagwood is. Anybody Grindr? Yeah, did somebody say Grindr? So I always hope that somebody says Grindr, because if you go into Publix and ask for a Grindr, they're gonna put your meat in the meat grinder because they don't know what that is. So we have different words that mean different things depending on where you are. If Spanish is your first language, there are words in Spanish that mean one thing in one country and something completely different in another country, and often could be a slur in another country. So you have to realize that words have different meanings for different people, and they have power. My mom used to tell me, sticks and stones will break your bones, but words will never hurt you. I think it's probably the only lie she ever told me. It's not true. Words can hurt, so we have to be mindful of that. Language and communication style issues we talked about. You know, some of us are really expressive. Some are more quiet. Some of us can't stop yapping. We have to be constantly talking, and some just like quiet time. Nonverbal communication. Some of you might remember this, that I've always taught you that Disney is who taught people in hospitality to point with the whole hand instead of one finger. Do you remember why? Because they've realized that the largest number of tourists to Disney are from Japan. And in Japan, that's the middle finger. So they would give you the Japanese the middle finger for a lot of years before they figured out that was not a good idea. If you were in Brazil, this would be the middle finger. And I forget where this is the middle finger. I have a book on my desk called The International Encyclopedia of Rude Hand Gestures. Seriously. The first time that somebody taught me about the one finger, I went to fact check it. And I found this book popped up for Amazon, How to Have It. So I could give you the bird in like 20 different languages if I had my book with me. Nonverbal communication. One of the biggest insults in the Middle East is to show somebody the bottom of your shoe. That is the rudest thing you could possibly ever do. And I have a friend who's from Pakistan, and her mother was here visiting and got ill. So she took mom to the doctor. And the doctor, at the end of the visit, sat down on his little stool and did what they typically do when he crossed his leg at the knee. So he was showing mom the bottom of his foot. She was done with him. There was nothing he could say to her. She walked out of the office and refused to have anything to do with him because she just knew that he should know that that was rude. So I'm not trying to tell, not even rude, but disrespectful. So I can't sit here and tell you should know what gestures mean in every possible culture, but if somebody tells you, then you want to know that that's not something that you want to do again. So effective communication helps us better understand people and situations, build trust and respect, and I like this, create environments where creative ideas, problem solving, and effectiveness can flourish, because that's clearly what we want here at Solid Waste Authority. So spoken communication, simple, always be polite and courteous. I know we probably think we always are, but sometimes we just might not be. We just might be a little snippy every once in a while, so sometimes we have to check ourselves. Avoid using jargon. I'm sure that some of you have acronyms in your department that nobody else will know unless they work in your department, and I would actually venture that there probably are acronyms that exist in two different departments and mean two different things, because we're pretty acronym heavy in this world, in this country. So avoid, make sure that people can understand you when you're talking to them. Use positive, not negative language, and non-judgmental, there's that judgmental word again. Be sensitive, doesn't take a lot. You know, read people and be sensitive in your communication with them. Be cautious with your humor. We do not all have the same sense of humor. What some of us think is funny, some people do not think it's funny. I've seen more blow-ups in the workplace over what was supposed to be funny, and it was not at all amusing to the person that was hearing it. And then try to hear yourselves as others hear you. The telephone. I've told every group that my pet peeve with phone is when somebody calls and you say, someone says, can you hold please? And before you can get to yes or no, they have already put you on hold. You know, so be mindful about how we speak on the telephone. The person on the other end of the phone, whether it be internal or external, deserves your attention and your grace. Written communication. Newsflash, emails do not have a tone of voice. Emails have the tone of voice that you assign it. And we do it all the time. If I get an email, my word of the week is, I don't know where I got the word from this week, but it's been snarky. So if I get an email that I think is a little snarky, I don't respond to the email, because I can out-snarky anybody. So if I respond the way I think they're speaking, it could just go straight downhill. So what I will do instead is I pick up the phone and I call them, because now I can really know what they were trying to say and not try to read through the lines. So realize that you really can't tell what there's no inflection in an email. We also, in emails, have lost a little bit of courtesy. You would never start speaking to somebody without saying hi, hello, something. We just start typing the email. No hello, no salutation, no nothing. Just, I need you to da 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 da. So think about, you know, how you're typing the email. And also, please remember that emails are forever. Emails do not go away. I do a lot of mediation work with HR departments in cities. And I was working with one city, and somebody was having issues with their boss. And when we sat down for the mediation, she had a stack of emails about yay thick that she had been collecting for years. But even if she didn't have the stack, they're on the server. They're out there. And not only do you have to remember that emails are forever, so you want to be careful what you put in writing, but yours are public record as well. You know, so you want to be sure that you're not writing something that you don't want out there. We've talked about verbal, nonverbal, and body language. And shared responsibility. We have a shared responsibility to one another. I did the first session in this room with your chiefs and directors, and I asked the boss, how many people work here? He said 400. So you got 400 employees. Today is Monday, September 26. Somebody in the 400 is having a bad day. It's almost the end of September. Somebody hasn't paid their September mortgage or rent, and they're concerned about being evicted. You know, that whole COVID no eviction thing is over. Somebody thinks their car might be repossessed, or it was. Somebody had got a bad health report this week or last week. Somebody's waiting for a health report. They don't know what it's going to be. Someone's had a death in the family. Someone has been asked to leave their home. Someone's been asked to file for divorce. Somebody's kid got arrested over the weekend, and they don't know if they can afford to get him out or her out, or if they want to get him or her out. Does that sound outrageous to you, that somebody in this building or one of your buildings is having something happen in their life like that? No, because it's true. It is. With 400 people, it's inevitable. So I call those not today days. So when we're talking about effective communication, those are not the days that you want to maybe give a negative evaluation. It's probably not the day that you want to put a new hire with them to have them train. It might not be the day you want to make them outward facing to do something with the public, because the public isn't always pleasant. So it might not go well. So it might be a day that we have to cover, you know, that we have to all band together and share the responsibility, because what we want, because what we want at the end of the day is a good representation of the organization. So if that person can't be that, then we need to share the responsibility to help them be that. Now, the only way anybody can know that is if you tell them. I'm not saying you have to tell them what's going on, but you may just have to say it's a not today day. You may not need to know why. Now, I've been saying all week that if somebody is having multiple not today days in a month, then maybe there's a problem, and HR has an employee assistance program for them, and maybe that's where they need to be, and there's nothing wrong with that either. But think about the fact that we need to come together and share responsibility for effective communication. It can't be one-sided. And to that, we all have a personal culture. Every one of you in this room has your history, the food you eat, the clothes you wear, the language that you speak at home, your traditions, your history, your economics. We all have our own individual personal cultures. So you got 400 cultures coming into this one big culture that is Solid Waste Authority. And it's an organizational culture that's very complex. You have a different culture than most places. Most of my work is with cities or nonprofit agencies. I don't work with anybody else who has chiefs. You know, something very different when I started working with you. It's a very different culture. You have your own language, your own tradition, your own codes of conduct. It's yours. You know, so we want to make sure that very often we think that all those individual personal cultures can come together and just work swimmingly together and never think about it. That's kind of not realistic. So that's why it's nice to have these conversations every once in a while to think about personal culture and the variety of personal cultures that you have in your workplace, the beautiful variety of personal cultures. So it kind of boils down to this, I read this, that all life is interrelated. We're all caught in the inescapable network of mutuality, tied together with a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all of us indirectly. Before you finish eating breakfast in the morning, you've depended on more than half the world. We aren't going to have peace on earth until we recognize the basic fact of the interrelated structure of all reality. And that's back to looking out of windows from time to time. So it's our hope that you've taken some shred away from this, little booster shot. We've been talking booster shots lately a lot. So a little booster shot for just remembering the cultural competency, the cultural differences that we have, and the need for us all to work together to have a smooth, effective workplace. And with that, I thank you. Any questions, thoughts, comments? I got scolded the last session because I didn't ask any questions. One of the guys had something he wanted to get in there. So any questions? No? All right. Well, I'll be around if you have anything. Thank you all. Have a great afternoon. Thank you.